Okay, good morning, good afternoon, good evening at different parts of the world, wherever you are, and a warm welcome to all the participants for being part of the outstanding webinar series of IEEE Consumer Technology Society. It's going to be a very exciting hour from now. We are privileged to have Danilo Pau with us to share his insights and thoughts on the following topic on tools and methodologies for better productivity, leveraging AI community-driven interoperability. Welcome, Danilo. It's an honor for us to have you here. So Danilo Pietro Pau is an IEEE and ST Fellow, Technical Director, System Research and Applications, ST Microelectronics at Rianza, Italy. Danilo graduated in Electronic Engineering at Politecnico di Milano in 1992. Since 1991, he is with ST Microelectronics Systems Research. He worked on HDMAC hardware design and MPEG video memory reduction, then on video coding and transcoding, next on embedded 3D and VG graphics and computer vision with handcrafted algorithms. Currently, his focus is on development of tools to bridge deep learning frameworks with resource-constrained applications on microcontrollers and sensors. Since 2019, Danilo is an IEEE Fellow. He currently serves IEEE Region 8 Action for Industry focused on internship initiative. He's also a member of the Machine Learning, Deep Learning, and AI in the CITESOC MDA Technical Stream Committee, IEEE Consumer Technology Society. With over 81 patents, 105 publications, and 113 MPEG authored documents, and over 40 plus invited seminars at various worldwide universities and conferences, Danilo's favorite activity remains mentoring undergraduate students, MSc and PhD from various universities. So once again, Danilo, it's an honor and privilege to have you with us. So please, go ahead with your talk. The stage is yours. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much, Anirban. Very kind and nice introduction, much appreciated. First of all, it's a huge pleasure and honor for me to be with you. So hi, everyone, and thanks for your time to attend this session that focalize on methodologies and tools to handle machine learning and artificial neural network in resource-constrained devices. And quite important, there are two keywords that I would like to underline. One is productivity, and the other is interoperability. And these are key words because when working in the artificial intelligence field, productivity is a game changer because it helps to really develop solutions exploiting diversity of communities. And here there are a couple of communities which are important to underline. One is the community of AI expert, and the other is the community of the embedded expert. And we need them to interoperate, to do development in a common way. And this is one challenge that some of the solution I will talk about, it's of, in my personal opinion, paramount of importance. And let's go through the presentation. You will see essentially some introduction to share awareness about the importance of artificial intelligence and how this can be applied on resource-constrained devices, and then how this can be explained with some practical examples. So first of all, start with the introduction. And you know, it's not by chance that I show the picture of Alan Turing because he is the father of the artificial intelligence. And then so let's wonder to ourselves if the artificial intelligence is the technology fad, as it was the DeLorean car, well famous during the early 80s. Or is it a technology singularity, which will definitely change the way we will do processing as it happened in with other in other fields like the physics, like with the gravitational wave discovered, that changed our understanding of the space-time. So I also compare the artificial intelligence to that, and I hope that I will provide some concept that are supporting my thesis, and that the artificial intelligence is really a singularity that is changing and will change the way we operate the signal processing. So to support my belief, I want to quickly go through some key milestones that hopefully justify the importance of this technology. First of all, we should remember quickly the Alan Turing machine back to 1936. This theoretical definition of a processor able to elaborate rules with the data coming from an infinite length input and output, which can also be used to define algorithm. For example, neural networks are Turing machine complete. For example, the recurrent neural network, the LSTM, and so forth. And then in 1950, in a well-famous paper, Alan Turing posed a very difficult question. And if there will be some time, computers which will perform properly on the imitation game. What is the imitation game? An interrogator, C, poses questions to machines, A, and to human, B, without knowing if A and B are either machine or human. And the questions are written, so there is no way for C to understand who is A and B. And when the questions will be answered properly, and they will be indistinguishable one from the other, clearly the imitation game has been achieved. And today, some of the technology that we see around in the field of artificial intelligence actually solved this theoretical definition that was defined by Alan Turing 70 years ago. And then in 1957, Frank Rosenblatt defined and developed the perceptron. Now, if you look inside the perceptron, essentially we can reconduct it as a weighted sum of inputs, passed through a nonlinearity, a sigmoid. Now, if you look inside the inner nature of every neural network and the inner nature of the neuron, you will find what is exactly the perceptron. And therefore, today, we are still using at the core of neural network such an architecture, which can be profiled in complexity through multiplication and additions. That obviously need a proper elaboration through processors and through hardware accelerators. Then, in 1989, George Cybenko defined an existence theorem, the universal approximation theorem, which essentially we will see later on, but define that neural network can approximate any input-output relation. And this was generalized 2 years later by Ornick with the multi-layer neural network. You recognize Sergey Brin, founder of Google, which stated that in 1990, everyone knew about neural networks, but essentially they didn't work. And the reason mainly can be summarized in 3 points. First, computational machines were not powerful enough. GPU at the time were essentially blitter, image blitter, and there was no programmable shader, no programmable languages, and no deep learning frameworks. That are the two of the fundamental reasons why there was people experiencing the winter of AI. The third reason was that essentially it was hard or even impossible to initialize and let converge the neural networks unless in a very narrow neighborhood of the result. And therefore, it was difficult really to proceed with that until in 2006, Goffrinton on science published a paper, very interesting, is a cornerstone because through restricted Boltzmann machine, he demonstrated that autoencoder can approximate human faces. And through stacked layers of Boltzmann machine, also they can be trained to approximate the input data statistics so that the reconstruction can be achieved with minimizing the related error. And from then on, started the proliferation of usage of neural networks. For example, in contexts that one of the most famous was the image large scale visual research challenge, where a lot of neural networks were developed. And in particular, since 2012 with AlexNet, no uncrafted old fashioned machine learning approaches were capable to beat neural networks. And neural networks were increasingly through the years more precise, more accurate, with increasing complexity. And this posed a challenge. Increased complexity means machines that need a huge computational power and storage capability to support them. But we will come back later on this. Practical application. One that I like to mention is the Google AI Assistant, and there will be an example. This is how the industry, for example, reacted and brought to product what was the imitation game theorized by Turing back in 1950. And then, obviously, multiple developments can certainly will happen in the future. But one that I like to mention is the athletic intelligence, which was developed by Boston Dynamics for humanoid robots. And it's really astonishing how the movements are realistic. And I like quite much the definition of the Boston Dynamics CEO, which was also a professor. And this definition of athletic intelligence is particularly important because it means that is applied to actuation. And this is another big field that we will see increasing of increasing importance in through the years, through the next years. As I said, back to 2012, before just shallow, uncrafted pipelines were capable to solve the problem, but with an adequate error. While after that, only neural networks were capable to achieve less than the human error. However, with an increasing number of complexity parameters and requiring a high computational power. But if we speak about applications, fine, and we will do that also with one practical example, but a bit of theory is also important because otherwise, just practice is dangerous in the sense that we don't understand what we are doing without a proper theoretical background. So let's focus our attention on the approximation. If I have a transfer function where x belongs to a real space d-dimensional, usually if in a certain in the neighborhood, a certain point, partial derivative exists, and so this is not a singularity. Through the Taylor series, I can build my approximator, which will approximate the function in the neighborhood of the interest point with an error small at will by increasing the series of Taylor in terms order of magnitude and so and partial derivatives. But look, this is the picture of my dog. The name is Lulu. I can't modelize analytically my dog. So what? How can I approximate this? Well, there is no transfer function that I can analytically explicitly modelize. And therefore, how to capture the input-output relation through processing? I cannot write a Taylor series to achieve that object. So there are problems that cannot be modeled as before. And the problem is even exacerbated if I focus my attention on some other details, high. This even so in case of multi-detail modelization, the problem is even exacerbated. But fortunately, George Saibenko in 1989 defined the universal approximation theory. What does it mean? It means that a single layer perceptor approximator exists such that defined as a weighted sum of inputs added by a bias passed through a nonlinearity. You remember the Rosenblatt perceptron, weighted plus an offset, generate an approximation which approximate the data with an error at your small at small width. So it is possible to develop such approximator by the point is to find from one side the weights and the biases through a learning process. And but what is not known by this existing theorem is how big is this single layer perceptron. So there is no detail in the definition about how to build this single layer perceptron. A couple of years after this theorem, Kurt Hornick extended through the multi-layer perceptron, saying that the proper approximator existed through a stacked composition of single layers with arbitrary bounded non-constant activation functions. And that generalized what Saibenko defined. So we know that the problems can be solved through multi-layer perceptron. But now let's after this short reminder of the theory, which comfort us on the subject, then let's focalize our attention on why this technology is so relevant to in the domain we operate. And therefore, I will use the definition of cyber physical systems. In cyber physical system, there are actually three domains. The physical domain, where we operate, where interface with the real world. The object domain, which is mainly composed by sensing units, which are sub-composed by three subunits, sensors, a computational unit, which typically are microcontrollers, and the communication unit of compliant with a variety of standards, which essentially convey the raw data from the sensor through a layered architecture to the cloud. And to the cloud, typically artificial intelligence, as we know today, is deployed. However, this high-level architecture poses a number of issues. Bandwidth. The sensing unit are essentially dumb unit and therefore can be intruded and have been intruded very easily. Energy. By concentrating the intelligence on the cloud, the complexity to be handled is huge. Think about the multi-layer networks that were dominating the image large scale visual research challenge. Hundreds of layers, hundreds of millions of parameters, huge number of multiply and accumulation per each single inference. So concentrating this complexity to the cloud underlying a fundamental assumption that there are virtually unlimited resources that should serve any application anywhere in the world, no matter what are the users, anytime. This is a huge task to be concentrated on the cloud. So we should wonder to ourselves if this cloud really exists and will exist in the future, and at which cost, especially in terms of energy. Latency, where is this cloud located and how the data can go through it, can reach it in through which topology. Scalability, by concentrating like every vertical system, the scalability is poor, and if let's say the central node, so the cloud, will be corrupted, all the services will fall and will be inactivated. So one example is the Google AI assistant. In such example, the lady speak with her assistant in order to book an hotel. So this is the need is recorded, and later on the Google assistant will call the restaurant to fix the appointment. As soon as the agreement will be reached in terms of time, number of person, and so on, this will be back annotated into the agenda and communicated to the lady. This is another example of how the mitigation game has been solved. However, it means that the intelligence in analyzing the speech, in providing the speech, in understanding and in understanding what the other human is saying and reacting in a so realistic way that the imitation game is solved, means to centralize the intelligence. And I want to state it very sharply, this is wrong. Why? For the reasons I said before. There are a number of drawbacks that we need to cope with. So let's play a numerical exercise. If I am speaking with a cloud through an audio coder, a compressing voice at 128 kilobits per second, I'm going to produce kind of 100 megabytes per day. Now, Android systems, which are the most deployed system in the world, the users are expected to be this year close to 4 billion, which means that if every Android user will use such a central intelligence by 3 minutes in a day, this will generate 11 petabytes. And back to 2017, it was already known that the Google Cloud nearly needed double complexity, double computational power, to cope existing services. So the problem now is really exacerbated. This is just one application, not the only one. Another can be the remote monitoring of industrial equipment. For example, if I have a rotating shaft, which is sensorized with biaxial accelerometers, with enough high sampling rate, then such as 20 kilohertz, then by making some mathematics, the amount of data generated is more than 27 gigabytes per day. And this is just for one motor. Imagine to deploying such service at worldwide level. As I said, energy requirements are huge in the sense that centralized intelligence, the power requirement for the data center is projected to become several hundred of terawatts per hour, which has a huge implication on the global carbon emission as well. Let's focus on one example, battery monitoring. I would like to monitor the battery charge of a battery pack. In one typical architecture, for example, used by the formula SAE Electric, which is supported by some university in Italy, like the Università di Padova, this battery pack is architected with 24 slaves, each one monitoring 6 cells. There is a host hardware which is receiving 2 kilobytes per second data rate, so the data rate is not huge. However, the monitoring, in order to check over current, over voltages, over temperatures, need this monitoring need to be checked in less than 500 milliseconds. Now, this may seem not a huge requirement. In the current cars, this is much, much less, in the order of tens of milliseconds. So, but this can be easily verified because, as you see, there are links to cross-check my statement. So let's figure out this problem, and which is posed some challenges. So I cannot monitor such batteries with cloud resources, not because of the data rate, but for the time criticality. So the intelligence, as you understand, the point I'm trying to sustain here is that the intelligence needs to be decentralized. By decentralized, the intelligence doesn't mean just to copy paste algorithms that are working on the cloud back to and mapping them to the sensor unit. This obviously is inadequate. There will not be enough computing and resource and storage resources in the MCU at the bottom of the hierarchy to implement such a huge algorithm like one of the that was developed by during the Image Large Scale Research Challenge. So we need to rethink deeply those approaches, and we need to design fundamentally them, considering that we are supporting devices which has got constrained resources. What does it mean in practice? Well, there are four rules that I would like to remind and use to make this mapping of artificial intelligence on microcontrollers, on resource-constrained embedded device to happen. First of all, if we are interested on neural networks, they shall provide accuracy which is higher than traditional machine learning or any uncrafted rules that an engineer can design. Otherwise, I would use classic algorithm. So first of all, accuracy is important. It has to be higher than existing methods. But then we need to implement those neural networks. And when we implement them on resource-constrained device, we have to fit into available memory, which is RAM. And typically, the RAM should be enough to store all the activations. The activations are the information that are input-output shared by the different layers in a neural network. And these are changing runtime. Inputs are changing, elaborated by each layer. Imagine just a weighted sum of inputs passed through a nonlinearity. This generates other data, and so on and so forth for the other layer. So this data shall be stored and fit into the available RAM. Typically, microcontroller embed RAM. So this is a very precious resource. And any mapping tool algorithm on those MCU shall use schedule and allocate and use very carefully the available RAM. Then the parameter of the network shall require a footprint which is inside which can fit into the persistent memory, so the flash memory, typically super integrated in a microcontroller. But there are microcontrollers which uses the external memory. In any case, there is a cap on it, and so the weights shall fit on them. If we are using, for example, neural network with 1 billion of parameter, these in floating point, these require for a billion of bytes, and there is no such such a memory in persistent memory in the MCU. So we need really to redesign the topology, making sure that the models will be tiny enough to fit in those resources. The fourth rule is a little bit more complex in the sense that essentially the processing time of the inputs shall be lower than the time of arrival from the sensor. So the first on the left is essentially the ratio between the complexity of the neural network, which, as I said, is dominated by multiplication and addition, divided by the computational power of the microcontroller. While on the right, we have sample in a Windows, because the neural network process inputs, which are organized in input tensors, divided by the sampling rate. So when this is respected, the available computational power by the MCU can sustain the complexity needed by the neural network, considering that in real time the samples are coming from the sensors, given a certain sampling rate, and to be processed without losing any kind of information. How to develop a neural network? And here we come to the point of the interoperability, which was in the title. One of the most developed used tool by the AI developers into the AI community is TensorFlow, abstracted through Keras. This allows to develop and to train models either in full precision floating point or also using 8-bit integer arithmetic through couple of quantization aware training or post training, so that you can train the neural network either compensating the quantization error during the learning process or not choosing to compensate because maybe is marginal using the post training quantization. What is the advantage? It's obvious, the weights of the network will be a fourth in terms of storage need. And also the activation will be 8 bits rather than 32 bits. But you can do that also using Keras API, which are abstracting the TensorFlow 1. In either cases, the neural network, which is exported, reside in a couple of files, which extension are called H5 and TF-Lite. What does it mean? It means that when I would like to map this neural network on the microcontroller, the first deliverable that I got from the tools are this type of files. So I need to operate with it, and therefore I need my mapping process on the microcontroller need to interoperate with such a format. For deeply quantized networks, so less than 8 bits, also Google is developing a new tool which is called QKeras, based on quantization aware training, which is built on top of Keras model. In all cases, once I define the neural network, train the neural network, and I'm satisfied in terms of accuracy, how to deploy them on the off the shelf microcontroller and even for in-sensor computing inside the sensor. So this is a challenge that is not on the AI developer, but is on the embedded developer, which is a totally different community, which are very expert on developing application for microcontroller, sensor, embedded processors, and they too use this output. So here you see that the interoperation, the interoperability subject comes into the picture. And how to cope with that? Well, one solution is to define a methodology in steps to map neural networks on resource-constrained devices. So the one that I propose you is the following. 5 steps. First, define the problem. For example, I want to develop my intelligent wristwatch that is able to understand if I'm sitting, walking, running, what type of activity I'm performing, whatever. Or my intelligent microphone that is capable to understand my keywords to activate more advanced functions. Another example is my smart camera, my intelligent camera. For example, imagine a security camera. I need to understand who is intruding my house, or maybe is a familiar, a person that is familiar with me. So I would like to discriminate intruders from people, friends, relatives, and so on, or even my pets. So these are the kind of problems that essentially imposes the selection of sensors. And therefore, with sensor, I acquire data. Then I need to define my transfer function. Remember the picture of my dog. I need to say that this is Lulu. This is a dog. And maybe you want to also discriminate the kind of animal. And maybe you would like also to discover other details, eyes or expressions or movements or moods or whatever you want. So we need to associate to the raw data labels, which are the semantic meaning we associate to the data. This is a very important process because it univocally defines the problem in terms of input and expected result. Starting from those, usually this is the most time-consuming part of the design phase, even 80%, 90% of the time. And it has to be carefully done and properly done with an exact protocol and methodology. Otherwise, trash in, trash out, garbage in, garbage out to any processing we can conceive. Starting from that, we start to build a topology. We will see some examples. And as I said, one can use a different deep learning framework that the AI community is using. TensorFlow Keras from Google or others that federated in an interoperable standard called ONNX. And therefore, the community is mostly divided in terms of interoperable formats into categories. TensorFlow Lite and Keras from one side. Google defined, and others that federated to develop such interchange format, ONNX. This is one key component to achieve interoperability. However, when I need to develop, as I said, this on the microcontroller or in the sensor, I need tools. I need tools because otherwise, and this is what the embedded developer community told many times, if interested in developing neural networks for embedded microcontroller, they need to write from scratch C code, which means also to validate it for a certain processor of choice. This is a manual process, time consuming, error prone, require a lot of time, require also assumptions in terms of processor to be supported. And therefore, late decisions are very inconvenient because they put in discussion the early requirement, the early assumption, and may require a respin of all development methodology, which is time consuming. In such condition, since this is very discouraging, some can be tempted to delay their investment on the technology. And and also this is a waste of resources because For example, on the microcontroller for IoT, we have something like 40,000 customers. Imagine that 40,000 engineers are doing such a job. So this is really is poorly productive. How we did so, how we solved this problem through tools that automatically generate, first of all, interface with such format, TensorFlow Lite, ONX, interface from with them, and automatically convert and generate optimized C code that once compiled on a processor can be efficiently executed using the minimal resources in terms of memory and computational power as possible. This is a totally automated process, we will see, and also fully automated. The tools, so these are from one side getting those AI format, the other side are generating C code. The tools for IoT are called STM32Cube.ai and for automotive MCU grade SPC5Studio.ai. Essentially, these are code generator with proper memory allocator and a built-in application to achieve a full code validation. And then the fifth step is to deploy on the field and check if the solution generalized properly with unseen data, which is the challenge for any machine learning approach. To do that, I would like also to mention the four requirements that were at the basis of this development. First of all, as I said, interoperability with the deep learning tool. So we, our technology interfaces with such a format exported by these frameworks in order to make sure that interoperations were possible. Secondly, the tool need to generate ANSI C code. Why? Because like on top, we are interoperating with the AI developer community. On the bottom, we are interoperating with the embedded developer community. So the tools are a bridge between the two communities. Since the embedded developer community usually want to be free to use any integrated development environment as they like, compile ANSI C code, the tool essentially shall generate ANSI C code. However, the tool shall be also application agnostic because application reside in the creativity of the developer, of the customer. So the tool shall not put any ties on who develop the application. So they can select whichever sensor they like, depending on the problem they set, and even be free to use or not embedded OS. And the fourth is that since the microcontroller in the top level architecture I shown is attached to a plurality of sensors, not even one, this becomes an AI hub, which means that the tool shall cope with multiple neural networks. So let's start now considering a case study. I want to, so my problem is to predict the battery charge. Let's focalize our attention. So having said all these concepts at high level, now let's see how this can be applied to an exemplary problem. Let's focalize our attention on batteries, lithium ion batteries, and let's define the state of health, which is the ratio between the maximum releasable capacity divided by the nominal capacity, which is the one that the manufacturer defined. This is a fundamental parameter because must be monitored in order to avoid risks, in order to avoid failures, in order to avoid even problems with the battery functionality. And usually a reduction of 20% in the nominal capacity is the limit that impose replacement. So now I want to show how the five steps methodology can be applied through such a problem. So first of all, I will share my environment, which is composed by a number of Jupyter Notebook, which are a very simple and effective way to show how data can be handled, preprocessed, reorganized, and how different neural networks can be developed. Once the neural network are developed and trained, we'll show how we can profile the complexity and deploy on the microcontroller. So there are three notebooks. I would like to quickly give you an overview. Let's start with the first one. The fourth one essentially takes a public data set from NASA, which you can find to this link, which is composed by different batteries. In particular, I focused on the dataset number 5 and selecting a number of batteries since they show correct measurements, while other shows only incorrect measurements. Then, obviously, there are charge and discharge cycles. However, for the remaining battery charge prediction, I want to focalize only on the discharge cycles. And in particular, focusing on that, I want to focus on a few number of samples. So the input of the observation windows is very narrow, just 20 samples at the beginning of the discharge cycle. And I want to predict the remaining charge at the end of the discharge. So the Python cell is composed by libraries that I import. And then the features we are interested are time, current, temperature, voltage. And obviously the expected result is the capacity. So all the MATLAB files are parsed. And then we create a pickle file from the MATLAB files that are composing the dataset. If we go through the local repository that I have, just a second. No? Okay. Essentially, these are the MATLAB files. And as a result of this script, we generate the pickle. Okay. So this is a simple data conversion script. Then we go to a second notebook, which essentially preprocess and prepare the data as we need for the further processing with the neural network. So first of all, from the pickle, we extract the features. And this is a plot of how the different batteries look like. So for example, the capacity is 1.8 average ampere hours, depending on the cycle number, and there are more than 1,000 cycles, value of the current, temperature, and time, and voltage. Okay, so these are the value that associated to different cycles in the dataset. Then we start analyzing the correlation. These pictures here shows how the features can be correlated, are correlated between themselves. So for example, on the diagonal, we have the maximum correlation, but this is obvious. Each feature is fully correlated with itself. However, we can notice that current and temperature are negatively correlated. Okay, current and temperature are negatively correlated. And so you see this is from a picture point of view associated with black color. while the voltage and current are positively correlated. Now, if we plot the variations of the voltage, current, temperature, and time, you see that there is a huge variability of the data. And this is inconvenient, really. Why? Because if the ranges in which they vary are so different, we need to compensate. How? With normalization. And why normalization is important? Because usually the machine learning, for example, classifier, calculate the distance between points. If they are in a very different scales, this create an offset, a bias, so that in favor of the feature with the higher range. Another problem is that also the learning process can be highly affected with divergence with such a difference in scale, and so on. So we need to normalize the data. How, for example, one typical method is using global normalization. Now you see in this plot that the feature have the same scale. Okay, so this pre-processing is needed before any processing, further processing with the neural network. Then we need to check carefully the data, because they can be outliers, or there can be even errors in the acquisition process. There can be a fault in the acquisition process. Okay, so we need to inspect the data before to use them. One example is this one. So we plot the histogram of capacity. However, we notice, and here you see very clearly the capacity ampere hour divide versus the cycles, that there are some values which are zero and then back to full value. Clearly, these are bugs in the acquisition procedure. So we need to skip them, essentially. And therefore, with another cell, we are removing the value which are below a certain threshold to make sure that the outliers are removed. Essentially, you are seeing that the preconditioning of the data is an important task. Acquisition is time-consuming, pre-processing and inspection of the data is of paramount importance, because if these data are left inside the data set, the learning process can be highly biased by this. It's like to put trash on the pipeline, and obviously this will create also classification data or results from the neural network that can be highly inconvenient. So this problem has to be carefully addressed. Once this is done, and therefore outliers and data have been checked, we can create the training test. In this case, the data set is divided in training and testing, where the tests are samples are 300 essentially, while the samples for the training are close to a little bit more than 1,000. So now we conditioned the data set and we are ready to start the design of the neural network. So there is a third script that is going to be opened soon, where essentially I'm going to load all the data so far generated. So I will skip them. Okay. It takes a little bit of time because this notebook is really complex, you will see. But once the data set has been extracted from the input as previously conditioned, and you see that we are considering input shapes for training and testing of 20 time steps times four features, time, voltage, current, and temperature. Then we start designing neural networks. Okay. I have different neural network designed, but essentially this is in Keras using TensorFlow 2.5. This is how the pipeline look like. This is a purely convolutional neural network composed by interleaving convolutional 1D dimension and normalization with activation, ReLU typically. So this kernel is instantiated multiple times up to a flattening layers with dense layers up to the output, and the output is just one value, which is the expected, the predicted remaining capacity. Now, you can see that these API, conv1D, batch normalization, and so forth, are the API inside made available by TensorFlow 2.5, by Keras. These are Keras layer, in fact. For example, how to read it? Here we have 128 filters, which are one dimension, so four taps, then 64, then 32, then I have dense, fully connected layers with 1,000 neurons, another 1,000 euros, and so on. So this is a quite complex neural network that we wrote by purpose. The model, once printed, suggests that this is the number of parameters, weights, and biases that feature that network. Now, this is an important thing to consider, because let's do a simple mathematic. These are 1, 4, 2, 3, 5, 4, 5, 7. Each one is a floating point number times 4 bytes. This is more than 5 megabytes. Okay, if I divide by 1024, this is 5.4 megabytes. Now, consider this device, the one that I put on the camera. I don't know if you are able to see it, but this is an STM32 in the Nucleo board with an STM32 H7 43ZI, which embed 2 megabytes in the same chip of flash. 2 megabytes, you understand that these 5 megabytes cannot fit, okay? So this network cannot simply fit into the microcontroller. There are other couple of things that we just don't know. What is the RAM occupation? The model summary doesn't say so. And what is the complexity? You remember, what is the fundamental measure of the complexity of a neural network? Multiplication and accumulation. So we need to understand what are these. So let's quickly show how this can be handled. So obviously I already trained this network, and let's use our tool that I installed through the command line. So I'm calling XCube AI through the command line. The version 7 is the latest release that we just made public for free to anyone in July, during July. Then analyze, because I want to analyze this network, and then I have to specify the model, which is stored into this directory. Now, obviously, I have different networks, and this is the complex one, this one, okay? And I want to know the complexity, and also I want to specify a couple of parameters which impose a better memory allocation of the input and the output information. I complete the command line output. Let's put every output in a directory that I called CNN complex one. Okay. And let's run it. What is happening behind the scene? the model is imported, is translated in an internal representation, which is very convenient to profile the complexity. And by profiling the complexity, it also generates C code and profile also the C code and shows a report. Now, let me go through the report. So it was here, quantization BMS. You see that this directory has been created, there is a report. Now, the report says, as expected, these are the number of parameters, 5.3 megabytes. The number of multiplication and addition, 2,246,881. Now, let's focalize our attention on this number for a bit. By average, so I give you an average number, which is not exact, but to give you a high level understanding, if every multiplication and addition takes 6 cycles of the STM32H7, I would have 2,246,881 times, oops, I have 2,246,881 times 6. Okay, so 13 million of cycles. 13 million of cycles. What is the time of each cycle? Since this microcontroller is running at top speed of 400 megahertz, 480 megahertz, I divide, so I multiply by the time for a cycle, which is the inverse of the clock frequency. So we have 28 milliseconds. Okay. Roughly speaking, this is a 28 millisecond network. However, this is just a speculation because I cannot run it on the microcontroller because it simply doesn't fit. Moreover, you can also see that as a result, the memory has been allocated for the RAM to store the activation during the internal computation layer by layer of 1D, passing data through the batch normalization to the dense layer and so on. Overall, it requires 11 kilobytes. So since the STM32H7 embed 1 megabyte, RAM is not a problem. Okay. However, the flash it is. You see this couple of zero because the input and out buffer have been allocated in the space of the activation memory. And this is quite convenient because reduces the overall required of memory. You could say, yes, but in this case, we have plenty of memory. Yes, but let's not waste any bytes of any microcontroller, because even if the resources are limited, I don't want to fall back on the concept that anyhow, virtually, these are more than enough resources. Every memory cell count in this space, okay? So let's go back. I am unhappy with that, but I want to characterize. So in such case, I trained the neural network and what I would like to show that I didn't run only one experiment. Let me go through. But I will run multiple experiments. And in this case, this plot is how the network is capable to predict in blue the remaining capacity versus the ground truth. Clearly, there are some inaccuracy, especially at the beginning of this discharge cycle. How to measure the accuracy through the mean square error. So in that case, the mean square error is across the experiment is 0.008. I don't ask you to remind this value because then I will summarize. Let's go to another model. In this model, I define another complex network But essentially, I am using less neurons in the dense layer. Okay, before were in the second dense layer 1,000, now are 512. Once again, let's go through the model summary. Now, these are close to 900,000 parameter. However, even this attempt is inadequate because 900,000, these are more than 3.6, let's say, megabytes, and we have only two, therefore even the complex two cannot be mapped. By the way, running the experiments, you see that even reducing the parameters, this seems to increase the mean square error. The mean square error is the difference between the ground truth capacity and the capacity estimated by the neural networks. So clearly, this seems to suggest that by simplifying the number of parameters, essentially by effort, this seems to suggest that the accuracy is compromised. However, even this is not implementable. Now, let's be drastic and let's simplify a lot the neural network. In this case, I'm using just one layer convolutional 1D with 32 kernels by four taps and a reduced set of dense layer. Couple of instances, 32 neurons followed by 16, and then just the output. In this case, I achieved a very tiny model, okay? This model is 21,000 parameter. Let's go through the training process and let's measure the accuracy. Interestingly, the accuracy is quite low in this case. Is even lower than the model complex one. In this case, is 0.005, okay? 0.006, let's say, because it's 59, while the complex one was 0.008. But in this case, we have a huge reduction in parameter, okay? And this is the network CNN TF2. So let's go and profile it. Let's go and profile it and let me check the availability in the directory. And save the models. And so this is the CNN. Okay. This one. So let's do the same as before, but is the CNN TF250. Let me check if the number is same option as before, but in this case the output directory is CNN. Let me call, as usual, the commands to analyze. Okay, faster than before. Let's go to check the report. Yes, CNN. Okay, so as you see, we have 21,000 parameters. 84 kilobyte in terms of flash, 32,000 MAC, and close to 3 kilobyte of memory. If we put side by side the two reports, yes, On the left, you have the tiny, the CNN model. On the right, you have the complex one. So there is at least two order of magnitude in reduction of multiplication and additions, and a drastic reduction in memory footprint from more than 5 megabytes to 84 for the flash, and from 11 kilobytes to, let's say, less than 3 kilobytes for the RAM. So this is also the result of the memory allocation that Xcube AI support. But you see that the accuracy was marginally was improved by using a tiny memory. This is what I was referring to at the beginning. The neural network deployed on the cloud must be redesigned, having in mind the usage of restricted resources. Now, we say that if I would be available such a memory, 5 megabytes, into the STM32, which I don't have, the computation was 28 milliseconds per inference. Let's check now the same in this case. So I have 32017 Mach times 6 divided 400 megahertz. So you see is 0.4 milliseconds. We moved from 28 to 0.4 milliseconds. So there is a couple order of magnitude in speed gain that we can experience from this mapping. Now, this is just the beginning, because then I went through several neural network design. So if you consider the previous network quite convenient, then I can further simplify the network using a deeper pipeline than the CNN, with a mix usage of normalization, conv1D, normalization pooling, and so on. Now, I would like to comment the meaning of such functionality. Essentially, batch normalization take a set of batches, a set of data in tensor, and compute the average and the variance in the batch, and then subtract the average and divide by the variance each activation, so that we achieve a normalization. And this is very useful to avoid to work at different scales, as before, as I did with the global normalization with the data. Since this can happen also inside the pipeline, this require careful normalization. Conv1D is a one-dimensional convolution. So since the kernel is 7 TOPS, basically the input tensor is read at 7 chunks of input. Each element is multiplied by a weight and then added by each neuron. And we have 8 different kernels. Therefore, the output tensor has 8 channels, equal the number of filters. The pooling takes, for example, in this case, it is the max pooling, takes a chunk of 4 activations and then replace at the output the maximum value. So it is a powerful tool to squeeze the tensor activation. Squeezing a tensor of activations will squeeze also the memory requirement, and in particular the RAM requirement. Therefore, by uncrafting such a network, also using, not using, as you can see, any fully connected layer just for the output, then what I obtain is a network which is quite small, 2000.7 parameters. Okay, let's remind. We started from 1.4 million parameters. We went down to 32,000 parameters. Now we are at 2.7 thousand parameters. Let's check the accuracy. Pretty nice. 0.0044. And except this section, there is quite nice fitting of the prediction versus the ground truth. Is that of satisfaction? No. I mean, this exercise is trying to design, to use as many as possible layers which are available from Keras layers in order to build a variety of topology, because I just wanted to explore them. I don't want to privilege any kind of network. I want just to sweep as many as possible network and check with their capability. Therefore, always keeping a feed-forward pipeline, then I start to use separable convolutions. And separable convolutions are quite convenient because are powerful tool to further reduce the number of parameters and as well the complexity. For example, Keras can be separable in two dimensions, and by separating the kernels in two dimensions, I can, for example, achieve a reduction of a third in terms of parameter and in terms of multiplication and additions. Let's go through the learning process. Now the model summary is 1,000 parameters, okay? While before was, as I said, I'm not taking notes, but I have a summary later on, 2,000.7. And now we are at 1.1. And the accuracy achieved, quite nice, you see, is 0.014. However, there is still this problem at the beginning of wrong prediction. While in the other part of the curve, it seems there is a good fitting. Then I can play with different topologies once again. This is worth to mention because I put, you see, separable convolution, batch normalization, and activation. I put the activation, in this case is a swish, which is a variant of the ReLU. I put just after the batch normalization. Why? Because the separable convolution is a linear operation. Batch normalization is a linear operation. This can be folded. Folded, by folding this, help to save intermediate buffering, and therefore memory, and therefore RAM. And this is convenient from an implementation point of view. Let's check from a model size point of view, 1,000 parameter. Let's go through the learning process, not satisfactory from a mean square error point of view. Remember that the best value we got so far was 0.0059. So we are back to some problems because you see that there are false prediction. Now it's time to move to other topologies. So far I used feedforward. Feedforward means that there is a direct acyclic graph where layers compute data that are passed through another layers and another layers, and there are no feedback loops. With recurrent neural networks, we start to consider also time dependencies and time correlations. And there are a couple of architectures that can be used. One is the long short-term memory, LSTM, and the other is the gated recurrent unit. Now, before to go to this, I would like to show you a picture that I think is helpful. Let me show the presentation. I was here. Okay, this is the architecture of the long short-term memory. Essentially, we have a state a belt, which is this one. Okay, let me check the pointer. As a point, which is this one. This is the state of the cell state of the long short-term memory cell that can be pipelined, obviously. This is the input, and this is the idle state. So the input goes, for example, through a sigmoid, which is a soft switch between 0 and 1. And this, imagine that this is 0. The output of the sigmoid is 0. So the previous state is forgotten. And this is, in fact, the forget layer. Now, if it is 1, the output of the sigmoid, the previous state is, and so the previous memory, is passed through the next one. Then imagine the input go through the sigmoid, and imagine is a 0. So as well, the input through the TANH, modulated through the, filtered by the TANH. If the input after the sigmoid is a 0, the new state imposed by the new input will not affect the cell state. So previously, imagine that I didn't forget the past, but if the input is not affecting the past, basically the memory stays the same. If I need to update the memory, the cell state, then I need the input to pass through this multiplier and be added to the previous state in order to generate a new state, and so a new memory. Okay? And then this is the output, because the output, the state of the output, passed through the TANH, multiply by the input, generate a new hidden state, and so on and so forth. This is the LSTM. Obviously, in very short terms, obviously I can do that forward in time and backward in time, so that I explore correlations between the features in both time directions. I would expect to achieve, obviously, more complexity, but also extracting better correlation by looking forward and backward the information in time. The last variant is the gated recurrent unit. As you can see, the cell state disappeared and merged with the input state. And then we have this update of the hidden state and reset, which is somehow equivalent to the forget input behavior of the LSTM. What is the main difference between, in terms of application, between the LSTM and the GRU? The LSTM is used to achieve long-term dependencies. For example, if I'm pronouncing phrases and I want to predict longer in time what I'm going to say, I need LSTM, a stacked pipeline of LSTM. If I am pronouncing short comments, this long memory is not needed. And therefore, I can merge the hidden and the cell state in the same by modulating through the update and reset gates. And therefore, this is more useful for a short time dependency, to exploit a short time dependencies, eliminating the sovercomplication of the LSTM. After this quick overview, let's go back to the design of the neural network. Very simple. 50 cells with recurrent activation sigmoid and TANH. Input shape is always the same. So this is a very simple LSTM. Let's go 11K parameters. Accuracy. Q Let's start to be better now. 0.003. We were 0.0059. Okay? So it's improving. Let's go now. I can mix them. I can mix feed forward, so conv1d and LSTM. I do the same exercise. 9,000 parameters. Accuracy worsened. I can do the same with the CNN GRU or the GRU itself. So just one layer of GRU. In this may be interesting because 1,000 parameter, so one of the smaller network developed so far. Let's go to the accuracy. Not bad, because we are 0.0038. Then the bidirection, and into the bidirection, it's a little bit more complex, 6,000 parameter, with an accuracy which is a little bit inadequate. Okay, and then I can design even a more complex with 128 cells bidirectional LSTM. The model is expected to be bigger than this, 136,000 parameter accuracy, 0.006. So let's sum up all these experiments. Okay. I'm going to select the right slide. Okay, this one. Let me just swoop. Okay, so this is the big guy. I'm going to implement all those neural networks. H7, based on M7 Cortex ARM architecture with embedded into the chip 2 megabyte of flash and 1 megabyte of RAM, 40 80 megahertz CPU. With floating point, with L1 cache, quite powerful. This is the one of the most powerful STM32. Okay. So all these networks were the one that I developed before in the notebook. From the complex one, the complex two, the CNN, the tiny, let's forget this for a while, with the separable convolutions, with activations after the batch normalization, LSTM, mixed LSTM, LCNN, GRU, GRU with CNN, and bidirectional. One of the best results were achieved by using the CNN with the 21,000 parameters, the LSTM with 11,000 parameters, but quite interestingly, the GRU with 1,000 parameter was very very nice, very good in terms of mean square error, one of the lowest. But let's go through the analysis with Xcube AI as I shown to you. First of all, 4 kilobytes of ROM. You may think that I'm underusing the STM32 M7. But there is a reason that I used, and shortly I will show you. The RAM is 768 bytes, so very small. MAC, multiplication addition, 20,000. Inference time, 0.5 milliseconds. Number of cycles per MAC, every cycle, every MAC takes 14 cycles. Okay, so this is exactly what a demonstration of how the problem can be solved by designing tiny neural network. Now, why I designed all of them, because and how I did this result, I want to show, first of all, that this is the graphical user interface with corresponding to the command line interface I used The central part is Xcube AI, is an additional component than CubeMX. CubeMX is the tool to pick up and configure and generate a general SQL template for any STM32. In particular, this additional plugin is to convert automatically neural network. And here you see a summary of all neural network. That's why I use the H7, because I can embody all these networks, okay? All these 13 networks. In particular, I also quantized using the post-training quantization approach of TensorFlow to 8 bits, because the other are using 32-bit floating point. In that case, I obtained interesting figures. However, we need a little bit of elaboration, because you may think, yes, but if you quantize from 32-bit floating point to int 8, you reduce by 4 the memory footprint, while you are not showing a reduction of by 4, because this is equivalent to TinyCNN. TinyCNN was 1 kilobyte of RAM. In this case, 3.6 kilobyte of RAM. While you see in term of flash 10 to 2. Why? Because really TensorFlow, the post-training quantization of TensorFlow, generated different topology. And this different topology required a different implementation. Obviously, a different mix of layers generated through the decomposition of TensorFlow requires a new pipeline, which is usually less integer 8, but is a different pipeline than the previous one. And therefore, it's better in this case to keep in floating point the previous pipeline than in term of RAM, that converting, quantizing, and converting into TensorFlow. This is one of the design choice any designer can work with. And then I skip for matter of time. If I generate the code, I can generate here on the right. The code, and I can run on the microcontroller, this is what I get. Now I am connecting the board and I'm opening a TeraTerm. Okay. So imagine that I generated automatically the code, which means that all this network you see on the left have been, this is a C code for the BRNN, for the CNN, for the CLSTM, all these networks have been automatically generated by Xcube AI. Then through the compiler CubeID, I generated the binary, flashed the board, now connecting to the board, and you see that the execution started. Okay, so we start with the CNN 0.583 millisecond, then the tiny CNN 0.282 millisecond, the tiny separable CNN 0.2 millisecond, equally the one with activation after the batch normalization. The LSTM is a little bit more complex, 5 milliseconds. The CNN mixed with LSTM, 2 milliseconds. Mixed CNN GRU, 1.5 milliseconds per inference. And half a millisecond for the GRU, one of the most accurate. 3 milliseconds for the bidirectional RNN. For the BNN with 128 cells, more complex, close to 50 milliseconds. 0.2 milliseconds for the integer 8 version of the tiny CNN. All this network are executed in time division by the neural network without any kind of RTOS. This is another example of how the tool is capable to convert this processor, this microcontroller, in a sensor hub. It means that it could actually monitor simultaneously, equivalently, 13 batteries with the time left, because I'm not fully loading the microcontroller. So in time division, it can control simultaneously different time networks. Certainly, with less time than the deadline required by the formula side, that was 500 milliseconds. But even if I would set a 10 millisecond deadline in terms of monitoring of the battery cell from the host, I could run in 0.2 milliseconds, well below, or one order of magnitude below, one of the most challenging requirements that I saw in the BMS domain. So I am already 4 minutes after the time allocated. If you allow me, I would like to conclude, and I leave this opened, with the equivalent version of for automotive. So what I'm showing here is SPC58 board. This is the microcontroller for automotive grade application. And what you see here is the tool, the equivalent tool called SPC5 Studio, that allows automatic conversion and generation of neural network for the SPC58 microcontroller automotive grade. In this case, I implemented one of the CNN, the CNN LSTM, and I can run the same neural networks on it. So let's, for example, run a simple analysis. I clean the project, then I generate the application. The technology embodied in this tool is the same of Xcube AI back to the version 5.2. So in this case, the network has been generated, and if we go into components, just a second, completing his job. Then if we go in components, okay. Done. My PC that is quite slow today. If I go in SPC5 components in configuration, you see that the C code of the network has been generated. You have the report. And the report in that case is 95,000 MAC with 0.2 kilobyte of RAM and 35 kilobyte of flash. Okay. So the same can be done on automotive grade microcontroller. I think I'm running out of time. Just let me conclude. So you see that I covered the five steps methodology. There are many, many details, maybe require other time to enter into it, because there are lots of features that I skipped to mention that allows you to design neural network with custom layers, with mixing also classic machine learning layers, and other advanced features that I don't have the time to mention now, maybe in a future webinar. However, I hope that by concluding, I gave you enough arguments to think that carefully that artificial intelligence is a singularity and that can be used to develop tiny neural networks that can fit in cheap microcontroller with scarce resources, very scarce than rather than the one available in the cloud, and to solve a number of problems. One of the problems I shown you was the battery charge prediction using an open data set. More can be done, but I think the methodology stay the same to solve also other problems you may consider. Thanks a lot for your time. I am always available to receive questions now or even offline, so don't hesitate to contact me. And I hope this was useful for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Danilo. It was an excellent presentation. We learned a lot from your technical insights and your knowledge. I really appreciate your time and your perseverance in giving us this wonderful knowledge. I would now like to ask the audience to have any questions, and let me have a look in the chat box if I have any questions from the people. So I have a question from one of the participants. The question is, why does the scalability decrease in centralized intelligence?
First of all, for two reasons. If you work in the cloud, you don't bother yourself with such tiny networks. When you use resource-restricted devices, you are forced to redesign the network, as I did, as I shown. Without that constraints, you have virtually unlimited resources. You have GPUs, gigabyte of memory. You don't care about energy consumption. One example, UseCollab. Okay? UseCollab, you have enough memory. You have enough computing time. Why should you bother with achieving a network in 0.2 milliseconds using one key parameter with a nice accuracy? You will stop at complex one, at the CNN complex one. Why to lose your time on solving a problem where you have enough resources? Yes, but in this way, the resources that you use are not infinite. One example I am referring to is that by supporting 3 minutes of speech recognition in the cloud, already in 2017, this is a public information, the Google Cloud needed to be duplicated in terms of computational power, which means it was not scalable. Imagine all the applications that one can design, speech recognition, image recognition, all these applications that even I cannot enumerate. How can the cloud support all of us in our application when a couple of years ago was not enough? And also, there is another consideration I want to take. So maybe I have a slide that supports me. Let me go. One that I hidden. Consider this microcontroller. Okay, this is the SD-WIN, one of the boards, very tiny boards that we sell. Okay, there is a microcontroller M4, and there is a plethora of sensors. Vibrational sensor, 27 kilohertz sampling rate, 150 for a magnetometer. Accelerometer 5 kHz, EMU 6 kHz. You have an heterogeneous sampling rate. So let's imagine 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 sensors. Okay? Now, a prediction back to a couple of years ago said that we have this year 50 billion of IoT things spread in the world. If everyone has 8 sensors, these are 400 billion of sensors. How can the cloud simultaneously serve such heterogeneous kind of sensors, each one streaming variable rate, raw? And I'm not mentioning images. for surveillance, for whatever other applications. Therefore, I mean, since this cannot be achieved, and there is no cloud, I claim there is no cloud able to serve such hundreds of billions of service or sensors serving heterogeneous application, either we are forced to monitor by ourselves the sensors, like I do with my surveillance circuit in my house, or we change the paradigm by decentralizing. And there is also another point. All these data rates need to be streamed to the cloud. I wonder if this network will ever exist. So that's the reason why I don't think centralized intelligence scale.
Okay.
I think there are physical limits.
Right, great. Thank you so much, Danilo. I think the attendee has got the information.
Thank you.
Probably we do not have any, yeah, no problem. Probably we don't have any question in the chat box. I encourage the people to please contact Danilo at his email ID. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask him. Okay, so thank you once again, Danilo, for this wonderful talk. And it was really an honor and privilege to have you with us for IEEE Consumer Technology Society. And on behalf of the Educational Activity and Educational Committee, and on behalf of the Vice President Gordana Velikic of the IEEE CTSOC Education Committee, I would like to thank you once again. And also I extend my thanks and appreciation to all the attendees for attending today's talk. Thank you, Danilo, and we would like to have you once again in our future. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was an honor and privilege to be with you today.
Thank you, and wish you all the best and have a nice day. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.